Good morning.
Happy Sunday, everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Hallelujah.
And I don't know about you, I think we should rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Because our God is a good God. Hallelujah. In every situation, in every condition, we can trust in our God because He is a promise keeper. Hallelujah. And His word is that He will be with us in the valley. Amen. Not that we're staying in the valley, but as we go through, He is with us. That's our promise we have. Amen. That we have a God who loves us so much that He promised never to leave us, never to forsake us. Hallelujah. That's why we can say that this is the day. Hallelujah. Just because God is a good God. Amen. Why don't we go before the Lord with prayer on today? Father God, we come to you in the name of Jesus, that matchless name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege to come before you in prayer, for the privilege to come before you in worship on today. Father God, we come magnifying you. We come extolling your name, God, because truly you're worthy, God. Hallelujah. In this world, there are trials and there are tribulations, but we thank you that you are with us through every trial, through every circumstance, through every situation, Lord, and we come to bless your name. We come to honor you, Lord God. We cast our cares on you because of your great love for us, Lord. We're just doing what you told us to do. So, Lord God, we come lifting up your people everywhere, Father. We ask, Lord God, that you would just heal the sick on today, Father God. We ask you, Lord God, to bless those that are in harm's way, Father God. We ask you, Lord, to just show up and let people know in a tangible way that you're with them. And we thank you for that. Father God, we bless you. We magnify you. We come to bless your name. We thank you, Lord, that you're always near to us. You incline your ear.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You incline your ear to us, Lord. You're not hard of hearing. You're not far away. Hallelujah. But you're near to us. And that's why we want to bless your name. We honor you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We lift you up, Lord.
Yes, we do.
Hallelujah. You're worthy today, Father. We come to give you the highest praise because that's what you're worthy of, God. Hallelujah. Be magnified today, Jesus. Be glorified today, Father. Hallelujah. We bless you. We bless you. Hallelujah. Give them the highest praise.
Give them the highest praise.
Because He's worthy.
For He is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest praise.
Give Him the highest praise.
Bless Him, because He's worthy.
For He is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest praise. Oh, that's the fruit of our lips. Sing hallelujah.
For He is worthy to be lifted up. Give Him the highest praise. Worthy to be lifted up.
He alone is worthy.
Worthy,
yes,
worthy, worthy. He is worthy to be lifted up.
He alone is worthy.
Worthy,
oh, yes,
worthy, worthy. He is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest
praise. Give Him the highest praise. He is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest
Give
praise.
Give Him the highest praise.
Hallelujah, He is worthy.
For He is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest
Give
praise.
Give Him the highest
oh,
praise.
God is worthy, worthy,
For He
worthy.
Is worthy to be lifted up.
Give Him the highest
Give
praise.
Give Him the highest praise. For He is worthy to be lifted up.
He alone is worthy.
Worthy,
oh, yes,
worthy,
he is
worthy. He is worthy to be lifted up.
He alone is worthy.
Worthy,
oh,
worthy,
yes,
worthy. He is worthy to be lifted up.
Lift Him up.
Lift Him lift him up.
Hallelujah, lift him up now.
Lift him up.
Our God is good.
Lift him up.
Yes, he is.
Lift him up.
Hallelujah, lift him up now.
Lift him up.
It's all about him.
Lift him up.
Who he is and what he's done.
Lift him up. Lift him up.
You're good.
Lift him up. Lift him up.
Oh, we lift you up, Lord.
We lift you up.
We lift you.
We lift you up.
Only you, Lord.
We lift you up.
Hallelujah. We lift you up, Lord.
We lift you up.
You're worthy.
We lift you up.
Yes, you are.
We lift you up.
Oh, we call you Jesus.
Jesus,
we lift you,
we lift you up.
Jesus,
Jesus,
hallelujah, we lift you up. Jesus,
Jesus,
there's something about
we
your
lift
name
you up.
There's healing in your
Jesus.
Name.
Jesus,
oh, we call you Jesus.
Jesus,
there's power in your
we lift
name,
you
healing
up.
In your name,
Jesus.
Deliverance in your name.
Jesus,
we lift you,
we lift you up,
only you, Jesus.
Jesus,
higher and higher, we lift you up, Jesus.
Jesus,
we love you,
we lift you up,
we adore you,
Jesus.
Place no one before you, Jesus.
Jesus,
we lift you,
we lift you up,
Jesus.
Jesus.
Hallelujah,
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 all the glory,
all the glory,
all the honor,
all the honor,
and all the praise,
all the praise. You deserve it.
Every honor you deserve.
You deserve it.
All of our worship you,
you deserve it.
All the honor
and all the praise,
all the praise.
Honor and the praise. We thank you for the word you have for us on this morning. I thank you, Father God, you would help me, Lord God, to speak your word. And I thank that it'll fall into our hearts, into a good place, into a fertile place. And we will be not only the hearers, we'll be doers of your word in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. So the definition of design is to prepare the preliminary sketch or the plans for a work to be executed in the form of a blueprint. Another word for design would be an invention, a pattern, a drawing. And the definition of purpose is the reason for which something exists, is done, or used. Purpose is determination along with having a reason for what you do. So there was a design for the lotion, like I said, in the lab with chemists. They had to continue to refine that design. They had to test to see if it was too runny, maybe too thick. So over a period of time, over a process of maybe a few months, maybe a year, they came up with the exact formula to make this lotion. And so when we think about ourselves and we think about how we're designed and how we're made, we have to reflect on the inside of us. Let's look at Psalms 139. And we've read there several times. I'm going to read a few verses from Psalms 139. And I'm reading for New Living. So purpose includes reason, use, function, intention, design. A purpose suggests a more settled determination. So it's the reason why we do something or the reason why something is created. It's not, it's actually intentional. It's not by accident. Verse 1 says, O Lord, you have examined my heart and know everything about me. Psalms 139, verse 1. Moving to verse 13, it says, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. How precious are your thoughts about me, O God. They cannot be numbered. I can't even count them. They outnumber the grains of sand, and when I wake up, you are still with me. And this is David's psalm. Verse 19 shifts gears just somewhat. And I believe David gets back into his warrior attitude, I'll call it. So David says, oh God, if only you would destroy the wicked. Now, in the previous verses, he's talking about being created in form and how precious he is. Then he goes into it and he says, destroy the wicked. Get out of my life, you murderers. They blaspheme you. Your enemies misuse your name. Oh, Lord, shouldn't I hate them who hate you? Shouldn't I despise those who oppose you? Yes, I hate them with total hatred, for you, for your enemies are my enemies. And then he says, this is the New International Version, God, see what's in my heart. Know what is there. Test me. Know what I'm thinking. See if there's anything in my life you don't like. Help me live in a way that is always right. So verse 1 begins, oh Lord, you have examined my heart and you know everything about me. And the Psalms ends by saying, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out everything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. So David recognized that as he made that shift, he did despise those who despise the Lord. But then he said, Lord, search my heart. Search my heart. If there's anything in there that's not pleasing to you, then put me on the right path. Philippians 3 and 12 says, not that I have already attained it, this goal of being Christ-like, or have already been made perfect, but I actively press on so that I may take hold of that perfection for which Christ Jesus took hold of me and made me his own. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider that I've already made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and reaching forward to what lies ahead, I press toward the goal to win the prize, or to win the heavenly prize, of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So there are times when I reflect on God's design and purpose for me, particularly when I allow the Holy Spirit to minister to me in a message. Sometimes I read a verse, I may hear a message that's been spoken, and it takes me back to wanting to maximize all the gifts and talents. As Paul said, I want to take hold of the things that Jesus Christ took hold of me for. And not that I'm already perfect, but that I'm pressing on toward those things. In Psalms 139 and verse 3 in the Amplified, it says, you scrutinize my path and my lying down, and you are intimately acquainted with all my ways. So God knows all about us. He is our creator. In Ephesians 2 and 10, it says, we are God's masterpiece. You are God's masterpiece. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Pastor wrote a devotional entitled The Morning Light. And in that devotional, he wrote the following words. Did you know that you are a masterpiece? One definition of masterpiece is this: the most outstanding work of a creative artist or craftsman. What is God's greatest creation? It is not the atom, the flowers, the oceans, the planet Earth, the sun, or the galaxies. None of these amazing items were made in his image and likeness. You are God's greatest creative work because he chose to craft people in a manner that would allow us to identify with God and have a relationship with him. The verse also states that he has created us anew in Christ Jesus. While every person is a masterpiece, at the beginning, as we're being formed in our mother's womb, every person is created a masterpiece. God didn't choose and select this person, but not this person. He knew us before we were even implanted in our mother's womb. So he already had us in thought and already had us in mind. So what happens is that while every person is a masterpiece, creation of God, those who have not received Jesus as Savior and Lord are not living anew in Christ Jesus. They look like a masterpiece painting that is hidden, discolored, and barely recognizable. In order to reach our full potential and display as God's masterpiece, We must acknowledge the one who created us and live a life that is pleasing to him. Those who have received Jesus as Lord and Savior can fully realize the benefits of redemption and new life. You look like a masterpiece, painting only hours after its completion, with all of this vibrant color and on full display. The best part of this, you are unlocked and now qualify to do all the good things that God destined for you before time began. And that reading is found in the Morning Light Devotional. So the greatest compliment given to one who creates something is that the creation becomes and accomplishes all that the Creator had in mind. Knowing who we are in Christ Jesus helps us to understand God's design and purpose that continues to guide us as we actively pursue the good things that he had planned for us before time began. Consider this thought. Because we are God's masterpiece, God fashioned every part of us, including our personality and temperament. So your temperament is your disposition, your dominant quality, or qualities that distinguish a person. Now, when we think about Psalms 139, we know that we have a physical frame. So there's a physical frame. God considered how we would look. But our physical part is our exterior. There is a core to us. And this morning we're talking about design for purpose. Design for purpose is the theme for this message. And I was thinking about, as we were being designed, did God not know that some of us would be outspoken? Did God not know that some of us might be a little rambunctious? Did God not know that some of us would be quiet, have a quiet demeanor? We are not by accident. All the qualities that we possess are intentional for his purpose and his glory. And you may be thinking, well, Sister Pat, I've read so many verses that say I'm a new person in Christ. Old things are passed away and things are becoming new. And I'm going to say yes, because as believers, if we think about it, we want old things to pass away. Amen. I was going to ask you, to think about, maybe you can recall yourself as a child. Just take a few minutes and think about some of the temperaments that you had as a child. Some of us were quiet and, maybe well-behaved. Others might have been a little bit more outspoken. Rambunctious means you were hasty, maybe like to get into a lot of things. My mom says shoot off at the mouth a lot. So those were personality traits or characteristics that we might have had as a child. And I think about, the children, my own children, and as we were raising our children, we saw qualities in each one of them that were distinctive. They're different. But as parents, we didn't make a distinction when we were making up our home guidelines and our rules and our principles. So as parents, we set in motion in our home, these are the things that we're going to do, these are the consequences. So all four children had the same foundation, our same family foundation. But when it came to specifically training our children with their abilities and the things that they possessed, we had to speak to them in a certain way, or we had to encourage them in a certain way because they were different. And in like manner, I believe that we're all uniquely made and that God has purpose and plan, and he's designed each one of us in that right. So there are challenges that parents face as we look at our children, and even myself as a teacher in a classroom. As I look at my children in my classroom, they're all different. And I was praying about this and meditating on this morning, that we know that God is real and that we are made in his image. Evolution could nowhere make all of you so unique. There are no two people that are the same. Not just by appearance. We're not talking about appearance, because we have similar appearances even in our families. We're talking about the inside of us. There are no two people that are the same. Only God Only God, as described in Psalms 139, could make and create us so unique and so different. And when I think about that, I thought, it's amazing that we can have billions of people on this earth and no two people be the same. God is great. Now, there are many that haven't come to the realization, as Pastor said in his devotional, haven't come to know Christ Jesus, so they're not aware that they're the masterpiece. But that's why he uses those of us that are believers to reach them, and someone, you know, reached out to us so that we're now aware of our design and purpose that God had planned from long ago. And we're walking in that purpose. And children, they are so different. You'll have a group that are pretty quiet, and they learn by experience with their hands. You'll have a group that listens very well. And even in this room, you're all different. But we're all the same when it concerns being believers. We believe and we have a core belief that's the same. So we're going to share this morning, we're going to take a look at Peter, and we're going to see what was it that the Lord saw in Peter. Because if you can remember, if you've read anything about Peter the Apostle at the beginning, Peter was pretty much, if I could picture Peter as a child, as a youngster, I'm pretty sure he was rambunctious. He was probably busy exploring, he was curious, and whatever came to his mind, he spoke. Because as an adult, he's the same type of person. So I'm saying that as a child, there were inside of all of us qualities and abilities and a personality and a temperament that God put there, not accidentally, but intentionally. And I thank God that we responded to him at a time in our life when we were able to allow those, I want to say good, but the things that were productive in our life, the kindness that we had. Maybe some of us were able to gather people together. Maybe some of us were helpers in the home. You might have been the child at home who always cleaned things up. Some of you think, Sister Pat, please do not take me back to my childhood. Please do not go back and ask my teachers or my grandmother or my grandfather, you know, or anyone who knew me about what type of child I was. So we're talking about those old things that passed away. They don't even be remembered anymore. All the things that I'm talking about are the things that I've just mentioned. The fact that you were caring. Maybe you were the joyous child. You were the happy child in the family. And now you still bring happiness. You have that wonderful smile. You were the hugger in the family. So you see, everything that was a part of who we were, God put it there in the beginning. And over the time between adults and coaches and parents and youth pastors and whoever has been mentoring us as children, there are children right now in our children's church who have the qualities and the gifts and the abilities that need to be molded, that need to be, you know, mentored, right? Because some of the qualities that they hold right now, they will have as an adult. Amen. So on this morning, if you can let go of the negative, you know, the behavior. I mean, children in general are selfish. Amen? We know that. Yeah. So we're not talking about the selfish qualities and I want my way. And, you know, children are really, I'm going to tell you the truth, they're liars. Amen. Well, it's true. If a child can lie to get out of trouble, they will lie and look at you. It's just a matter of fact. Every child is lying. So if you were a lying child, we're not talking about lying this morning. So all of those things we can dismiss because God has made us anew in Christ Jesus. So what are the parts of your personality, your temperament? For some of you, going from this side of the room to that side of the room and making eye contact might have been a challenge. But God wants to use you. For me, I was very much an introvert and very much shy. And so after becoming a believer, those tendencies continued to stay in my life. And then, of course, Pastor and I were married. And he's a minister, and then he becomes a pastor. So there has to be a balance in my life, because now I've got to allow the grace of God to take me to a different part that used to be a comfortable part for me. So that's what happens in our life, that though we might have been quiet and introverted, we might have been shy or fearful as a child, that has to be set aside when God calls you to do something. I remember that pastor said concerning Sean, and he approached her about, has God called you to be a minister? And she spoke out the same way I responded, but I'm scared. That's just real. Amen. And then you realize, but if I allow fear to inhibit what God's called me to do, then I'm not letting Christ be anew in my life. And so as we look at Peter, you can turn to Luke. So we'll start by, well, you know what? I'm going to read in Mark. You can turn to Luke. In Mark, I've enjoyed researching and looking at scriptures about Peter. Maybe because his personality is so different than my personality, I wanted to see what it was about Peter that God saw in him. So years ago, Pastor was reading on Easter morning this scripture. Now when the Sabbath was passed, this is Mark 16. Now when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and another lady brought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen. And they said among themselves, who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us? But when they looked up, they saw the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. There's an angel. But he said to them, do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He's risen. He's not here. See the place where they laid him. And then verse 7 says, this is the version that Mark has written in the Gospels. He says, but go tell his disciples and Peter. So the other Gospels don't mention Peter by name, but Mark mentions Peter by name. So go tell his disciples and Peter that life is going before you, that he is going before you into Galilee. There you will see him as he said to you. And now look at Luke. So we'll start reading at Luke at the Last Supper. And I'm reading in verse 31, Luke 22, verse 31. Jesus speaking, Simon, Simon, or Peter, Simon, Peter, Simon, Peter. Simon, Simon, Satan has asked to sift each of you like wheat, but I've pleaded in prayer for you, Simon. So specifically, he's talking to Peter again. But I've pleaded in prayer for you, Peter, that your faith should not fail. So when you have repented and turned to me again, strengthen your brothers. He's speaking in the future. He's speaking in the future. Peter is unaware. So Peter, okay, Jesus. If you've read anything about Peter, you know he's kind of casual. He's we're going to talk about some of his characteristics. Okay, Lord. So then he says, so Peter speaks up again. He speaks up all the... From my readings that I've read in the Gospels, Peter is most often the first one to answer. If Jesus asked a question, if anything was going on, Peter's going to speak up. But that was a part of his temperament. And God is going to use, God is using what we would say was running off at the mouth. God's going to take that and use it for his glory. And I'm saying he's done the same thing for us. He's used and he's tapped into some of the temperaments that we have. He's had to mold them. He's had to mentor us somewhat so that we could be used for him for his glory. He's had to, as we said, examine our heart. See what's in there, Lord. If there's anything that doesn't look like you, that's the old thing we're going to pass away. So I'll keep reading here, and it says, Peter said, here's Peter again, Lord, I'm ready to go to prison with you and even to die with you. Jesus said, Peter, let me tell you something. He's saying, let me tell you something about yourself that you don't even know about yourself, but I know your heart. Before the rooster crows tomorrow morning, you will deny 3 times that you even know me. Now, that's pretty bold. Peter said, I'm going to prison with you. The Lord said, just wait a minute. I know something about you you don't know about yourself. This is what's going to happen tomorrow. And we'll now let's look at what happened. So we'll read down, skip down to Luke 22, verse 54. Having arrested him, they led him and brought him into the, this is Jesus, into the high priest's house, verse 54. But Peter followed at a distance. Now when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter said among them, and a certain servant girl, seeing him as he sat by the fire, looked intently at him and said, this man was also with him. But he denied him, saying, woman, I do not know him. In a little while, another saw him and said, you are also of them. But Peter said, man, I'm not. Then another, about an hour had passed, another confidently affirmed, saying, surely this fellow also was with him, for he is a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I do not know what you are saying. Immediately, while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed. And the Lord turned, and this is the version from Luke, it says, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered, was reminded. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord and how he had said to him, before the rooster crows, you will deny me 3 times. 62 says, so Peter went out and wept bitterly. And I believe that's why in the Gospel of Mark, the angel said, be sure Peter comes. The Lord knew that Peter would deny him, but he wanted to restore Peter. In order for Peter to fulfill God's design and purpose to be an apostle in the early church, Peter had to be restored. He wept bitterly because God knew what was going to happen. The Lord knew it was going to happen. But at the same time, he knew that he could be restored. And so there are times that we have often missed the mark, that we haven't seen what God sees in us. As I was saying, we have maybe allowed fear or a lack of preparation, a lack of education, our physical appearance. We don't look the part. We don't act the part. But I'm telling you that when you were being created, you're God's workmanship, you're God's masterpiece. It was not by accident. You are intentionally created and made the way that you are. And it's okay to celebrate who we are, amen, because we know that God is working in us, both to will and do his good pleasure. And so whatever he's called me to do, he's equipped me to do. Some of the things that I learned about Peter, just a few here, we can turn to, let's look at Matthew 14. Matthew 14, verse 22. Peter was zealous. Zealous defined as enthusiastic, passionate, fervent, eager, obsessive, and intent. So Matthew 14, 22, immediately after this is Jesus after he's spoken to the crowd. Immediately after this happened, Jesus insisted that the disciples get back into the boat and cross to the other side of the lake, which he sent the people, and then he sent the people home. After sending them home, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. And then night fell while he was there alone. Meanwhile, the disciples were in trouble far away from land, for a strong wind had risen, and they were fighting heavy waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them, walking on the water. When the disciples saw him walking on the water, they were terrified. And in their fear, they cried out, "It's a ghost!" But Jesus spoke to them at once. Don't be afraid, he said. Take courage, I am here. So who is the first person to speak? Peter. Of course, because so that's the part of him that's zealous, impetuous, impulsive. So Peter speaks up. Well, Lord, if it's really you, we don't know it for sure. You said it's you. You know, I mean, I'm just kind of paraphrasing, right? But maybe Peter's thinking, well, he said it was him, but I'm not really sure if that's really the Lord. Well, Lord, if it's really you, tell me to come to you walking on the water. And if I can walk on the water, I know it's really you, Lord. So that's a part of, right? That's a part of his character, right? No one else spoke up and wanted to jump out the boat and get in the water. So he's a go-getter, right? He's a go-getter. He's a fighter. I mean, you know, think about that. Think about that. That's how he was as a child. That's in him. And so we look at this and it says, Jesus says, yes, come. So Peter went over the side of the boat and walked on the water toward Jesus. But when he saw the strong winds and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. Save me, Lord, he shouted. Jesus immediately reached out and grabbed him. You have so little faith, Jesus said. Why did you doubt me? Let's take a look at Matthew. We're still in Matthew 16. So Peter was impetuous. Impetuous defined means he was impulsive. He was hot-headed. He was rash, hasty, reckless. Well, he jumped out the boat and began to walk on water. He didn't put thought to it. But like I said, his character. These are just a few verses. If you have an opportunity to look at Peter's life and do a study on Peter, you'll find that he spoke up often and quickly, and he wasn't always correct. So in Matthew 6, and let's go to Matthew 6:21 first. And it says, Jesus predicts his death. So Matthew 6:21, from then on, Jesus began to tell his disciples plainly that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem and that he would suffer many terrible things at the hands of the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but on the third day he would be raised from the dead. Verse 22. But Peter took Jesus aside. Now that's pretty bold, right? So Jesus just tells the disciples about his death and what was going to happen. So Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, he said, this will never happen to you. He's speaking to the Messiah. But that's what is. Oh, I'm sorry. Matthew 16:21, and now we're on verse 22. And I'm reading from New Living, so it may sound different. Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Heaven forbid, Lord, he said, this will never happen to you. Jesus turned to Peter and said, get away from me, Satan. You are a dangerous trap to me. You are seeing things merely through a human point of view and not from God's. So Peter speaks up. But Peter was also a disciple. A disciple is a student, a learner, and a seeker. So there is a balance in Peter's life as he begins to be molded, amen, and mentored. He was a follower of Jesus. He was a student. He was a learner. He asked Jesus questions when he didn't understand situations. And Simon means hearer. Peter means rock. And Jesus spoke of him as being the rock. He was an example or symbol of learning, of knowledge. And on this rock I will build my church. He called him Peter. I won't read that, but I'm sure you've read that verse. So Peter had on the inside of him the desire to know. And that's the part that God saw in him. That's the part that the Lord saw in him. Jesus is, and I'm reading right now from a commentary, so it's going to sound pretty structured, but I like the reading of it, and I think it brings to heart what I'm attempting to share to you today. But this was not written by me. So Jesus' first words to Simon Peter were, come be my disciple. His last words were, you follow me. Every step of the way between those two challenges, come and follow me. Peter never failed to follow, even though he often stumbled. When Jesus entered Peter's life, the fisherman became a new person with new goals and new priorities. He did not become a perfect person, however, and he never stopped being Simon. I never stopped being Patricia. Never stopped being Patricia. I am created. My mother named, my parents named me. But when I became a new person in Christ, old things have passed away. And Pastor says, old things have passed away, all things become new. It didn't say we get all new things. There's a difference. I want some old things to pass away, amen? As Pastor says, some of you were a certain way, but all of us had sin, amen? All of us walked in sin. All of us had, I said, every child lies. Some of us, you know, took things we didn't always pay for. I mean, let's just be real. Some of us were places we weren't supposed to be. So all those old things have passed away. But on the inside of me, it says, he never stopped being Simon. That really said something to me. That God knew, and I keep on saying this, but I want you to understand that, and I hope that I'm getting this message to you, that you are designed for purpose. And your design for purpose includes who you are as a person. And that the things that we see, my fear of speaking initially, and I still have to rely on the grace of God even this morning, but whatever fears we have, whatever reasons we want to give for not having the boldness to walk in the things God called us to walk into, he's patient, and he will put people in our lives like I had you this morning. You didn't anticipate doing that, but I had you to go find somebody. So God just gives us experiences. He gives us opportunities at times to do something we couldn't do in and of ourselves. I can recall that there was one time my husband and I were in California at a pastor's conference, and I was in the elevator with one of the leaders the convention we were a part of, and we were just riding together in the elevator, and she said, oh, I'd like for you to facilitate the women's meeting tomorrow. I should have took elevator number 4. My thought was, I'm on the wrong elevator at the wrong time. I'm just going to be honest with you. I started to get weak in my knees, and immediately, this has been a few years ago, but as soon as she said it, immediately fear gripped me. I'm just going to be honest with you. And my first thought was, what am I going to say? How are people going to receive? Because then it became about me. What am I going to wear? I mean, we're talking about hundreds of women at a big conference. And I said, Lord, I've never stood in front of a lot of women. And couldn't she have chosen somebody else? All of these thoughts just ran through my mind. I didn't just say, yes, Lord, I'm going to do it, because my natural nature was not like that. So I resorted back to, I never stopped being Patricia. I'm going to sit on the 10th row back there, or the 12th row, and then I'm going to receive the word from the minister. Now, I wasn't going to be the speaker. I just was going to facilitate the meeting. And so I got back to the room, because they had separate men's and women's sessions. And my husband said, well, how did your meeting go? Because every morning we had separate men's and women's sessions, and I was telling him everything was wonderful. And I said, Sister Johnson asked me to facilitate the women's meeting on the morning. He said, that's great. So for him, it wasn't even about, are you going to do it? He said, that's great. And so as soon as he said that, there was just a peace. What am I going to do? Not do something God asked me to do? I'm going to let fear and my own image of myself keep me from doing what God called me to do. And so, you know, I had to balance it. And I can say, I don't remember everything I said. I don't remember how the people received me. I just remember that I said yes. And it was an auditorium full of women. Hallelujah. And as soon as I got on the stage without falling. That was one fear. You know, in a hotel, there's this platform, right? You got to get up on the platform first. Okay, Lord, I'm not going to trip and fall. See, you don't think like that, but I'm just going to be honest with you. So when I made it to the platform, and I think I got everybody's name right, because you got to introduce all parts of and keep it flowing, you know, what a facilitator does. Now, in my picture of myself, I wouldn't choose me to be a facilitator. I mean, I just wouldn't. Because a facilitator has to keep the meeting moving and, you know, make sure you add in a few comments. And some of you will be natural facilitators. It would just come out of you because you speak well and you like to be around people and you have all these ways of interacting. Elder Owens, I mean, he could facilitate the whole meeting. He inserts at the right time, the right words, and makes you laugh. And I thought, well, okay, but God said, you can do this. And so, amen. And so that's what I'm saying. I never stopped being Patricia, but I allowed the Lord, through His Holy Spirit and through the grace that He put in me, to make me walk in the things that I wasn't naturally thought I was capable of doing. It goes on to say, we may wonder what Jesus saw in Simon Peter that made him greet this potential disciple with a new name, Peter the Rock. Impulsive Peter certainly didn't act like a rock much of the time. But when Jesus chose his followers, he wasn't looking for perfection. He was looking for real people.
Amen.
Like Patricia.
Amen.
Patricia Ann.
Amen. Yeah.
Born to Emerson and Mary Blunt with three brothers. Born in Columbus, Mississippi. Raised in Indianapolis, Indiana. Real people.
Hallelujah.
He chose people who could be changed by his love. And then he sent them out to communicate his love was available to everyone, even to those who often fail. We know Jesus loved Peter in spite of his failures. Peter went on to do great things for God. Thank you, Lord. Designed for purpose. Designed blueprint, crafted, intricately made, and he's always thinking about us. He examines our heart. And as I just read, God knew all about Peter, and he still decided he would use him. So I thank you, Lord, that at the right moment, when the gospel was preached to each one of us, we received you as Lord and Savior. And I think I thank you for the benefits that come with salvation, that you have made old things pass away and you've given us some new things. And you're letting us walk this life, Lord, being used by you, giving us the boldness we need. And at the same time, allowing us, Lord, and being reminded of what you intentionally created us to be. We are your workmanship. We are created in your image.
I know you enjoyed that message by Patricia Hudson. I appreciate her gift and the fact that she's designed for purpose as a school teacher, as a pastor's wife and a minister in her own right. I thank God for that word. Trust you will. Let that word resonate on the inside of you. Amen.
If you need prayer, log in to our church website and fill out the form. We'll get back to you right away. It's important to connect, to share your prayer need. Let us pray with you. Let us stand with you, all right? So go to the site, newcovenant.org. Let me share with you that for several years, we have been doing online prayer with a conference call number. We call it Circles of Prayer and Care. And I want you to check out this screen graphic now, and you take note of that number. There's nothing more powerful than prayer, nothing more encouraging than prayer. So pick up your phone and call that number and join the prayer group. Let me share, it's offering time. God has blessed us to be givers and receivers of His blessing. Now, New Covenant Church, we're doing a lot of work in our community and around the world. We're supporting a life-changing orphanage in Kenya. It's called the Global Field Evangelism. We've been blessed to sponsor an orphan, a young lady who is growing up in the grace of God, who's being educated and loved, along with the other children there, whose parents have died or have suffered injury or death from violence. But they're at the orphanage and being raised there, and they're coming through in strong ways. There are many ways to give. You can use Zelle, you can use Cash App, PayPal, you can also give using Givelify or just plain old postal mail. But thank you for your faithfulness. I mean, God's been keeping us and blessing us during this season. I mean, God is so faithful. God's people are faithful. I want to thank you for giving, for being so faithful. It's amazing to see God's grace on your life. And I pray God's blessing on you. And I pray God will bless the seed you are sowing right now. I'm praying a hundredfold blessing on that seed. That's biblical, not hype. God promised to do this, amen? So you go ahead and give and let God bless you. So for my wife, Patricia, we say God bless you. We love and appreciate you. From a New Covenant Church family, we want you to join us on Wednesday for Bible study, Firm Foundation Bible Study, and then come back on next Sunday. We have a praise team ministering next Sunday. It's going to be a great time. So we'll get through this together. Be safe. Stay connected. God is good all the time, and every good thing happens on a firm foundation. God bless. Say